soldiers, faithful, true, and bold, fight as the safety nobly fought of old, and win with them the victor's crown of gold. Alleluia, alleluia.
Good morning and a very warm welcome to you this morning. I have an announcement I'm very sad to have to make first thing before we start. Late last night we heard from Bishop Dagmar that all church services will now be suspended from the 5th of November in line with government guidance on our new national lockdown. So this is the last time we'll be able to gather here together until the 6th of December, I think. So it's doubly special that you're all here to join with us all in communion. We will be trying to do online services and trying to keep our spiritual morale up. So do look out for our YouTube services, and I'm sure we'll be communicating with you during the week to let you know a bit more of what's going on. So let us now begin our service. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And let us now take a few moments to sit in silence before God and bring to him all our worries, all our troubles, all those things we have done or shouldn't have done, all those things which we ought to have done, and lay it before him. And let us now join together in the words of the confession. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
our collect for today. God of holiness, your glory is proclaimed in every age. As we rejoice in the faith of your saints, inspire us to follow their example with boldness and joy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The reading is from the book of Ruth, chapter 2. Now Naomi had a relative on her husband's side, a man of standing from the clan of Elimelech, whose name was Boaz. And Ruth the Moabite said to Naomi, "Let me go to the fields and pick up the leftover grain behind anyone in whose eyes I find favour." Naomi said to her, "Go ahead, my daughter." So she went out, entered a field, and began to glean behind the harvesters. As it turned out, she was working in a field belonging to Boaz, who was from the clan of Elimelech. Just then, Boaz arrived from Bethlehem and greeted the harvesters. "The Lord be with you." "Lord bless you," they answered. Boaz asked the overseer of his harvesters, "Who does that young woman belong to?" The overseer replied, "She is the Moabite who came back from Moab with Naomi." She said, "Please let me glean and gather among the sheaves behind the harvesters." She came into the field and has remained here from morning till now, except for a short rest in the shelter. So Boaz said to Ruth, "My daughter, listen to me. Don't go and glean in another field, and don't go away from here. Stay here with the women who work for me. Watch the field where the men are harvesting, and follow along after the women. I have told the men not to lay a hand on you. And whenever you are thirsty, go and get a drink from the water jars the men have filled." At this, she bowed down her face to the ground. She asked him, "Why have I found such favour in your eyes that you notice me, a foreigner?" Boaz replied, "I've been told all about what you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband, how you left your father and mother and your homeland and came to live with a people you did not know before. May the Lord repay you for what you have done. May you be richly rewarded by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge. May I continue to find favour in your eyes, my Lord," she said. "You have put me at ease by speaking kindly to your servant, though I do not have the standing of one of your servants." At mealtime, Boaz said to her, "Come over here, have some bread and dip it in the wine vinegar." When she sat down with the harvesters, he offered her some roasted grain. She ate all she wanted and had some left over. As she got up to glean, Boaz gave orders to his men, "Let her gather among the sheaves and don't reprimand her. Even pull out some stalks for her from the bundles and leave them for her to pick up and don't rebuke her." So Ruth gleaned in the field until evening. Then she threshed the barley she had gathered, and it amounted to about an ephah. She carried it back to town, and her mother-in-law saw how much she had gathered. Ruth also brought out and gave her what she had left over after she had eaten enough. Her mother-in-law asked her, "Where did you glean today? Where did you work? Blessed be the man who took notice of you." Then Ruth told her mother-in-law about the one at whose place she had been working. "The name of the man I worked with today is Boaz," she said. "The Lord bless him," Naomi said to her daughter-in-law. "He has not stopped showing his kindness to the living and the dead." She added, "That man is our close relative. He is one of our guardian redeemers." Then Ruth Ruth the Moabite said, he even said to me, stay with my workers until they finish harvesting all my grain. Naomi said to Ruth, her daughter-in-law, it will be good for you, my daughter, to go with the women who work for him, because in someone else's field you might be harmed. So Ruth stayed close to the women of Boaz to glean until the barley and wheat harvests were finished, and she lived with her mother-in-law. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our series on Ruth in the first chapter, and thank you Piers for reading so well this morning, come along in the story. So if you remember, Ruth decided last week that she wanted to be with God and with God's people, and Simon thought about big decisions that we might have to make, and what a big decision Ruth decided to make, to follow her mother-in-law to a strange land, to a strange God. She put her trust in the Lord, and the Lord has led them back to Israel. And Simon also encouraged us to be thankful for whatever difficulties we face. God is with us. And how prophetic do those words feel this morning when we're facing another national lockdown? And how hard it feels to be thankful in the face of another month of being effectively home prisoners. But like Ruth, we have to trust that God knows best, that God is loving, and that God brings good out of every situation. So this morning we join Ruth and Naomi, and they are in dire circumstances. They're both widows. Very poor, very vulnerable. They have no means of supporting themselves. So Ruth goes out and makes a scratching of a living gathering up the leftovers in the fields, just trying to find enough to eat, and maybe a bit left over to save or to sell. And we must picture Ruth as a very young woman, possibly, very vulnerable, without a protector. And of course, in those days, women were not really expected to go out and work. They were very much encouraged to be at home, a very different time to now. And the women could only go out and about with the protection of a man. We have a very different situation here, but I think we can all really resonate with Ruth's experience that sometimes we can be out and we can feel vulnerable. And I think this lesson today, especially when the Prime Minister announced yesterday another national lockdown, we can feel very vulnerable. And of course, Ruth is also a foreigner in a foreign land. She's not Jewish, she's a Gentile. And so she's doubly vulnerable because there was a lot of hostility towards Gentiles, and particularly Moabites, who were thought to be promiscuous. So you can see the danger Ruth would have been in as she was gleaning in those fields, with men thinking she was the sort of woman who might encourage that sort of behaviour. But Ruth, wonderful Ruth, full of courage and boldness, looks forward and acts. She doesn't stay at home worrying. She goes out and tries to make a living for her and Naomi. She shows great courage and loyalty in the face of great difficulty and trusts that God will provide. Now, one of the theological debates on this book is, where is God? Where is God in the book of Ruth? He's barely mentioned. And in fact, in a couple of weeks' time, hopefully, you will hear Lucinda talking about the time when God is mentioned in chapter 4, when the Lord God helps Ruth conceive. But God's absence, is that something that resonates with us perhaps today? However, this book gives us real hope that God provides in adversity. That even though we may not feel God is there, he is. He's an ever watchful presence, a quiet presence, but there. And in the story of Ruth and Boaz, we can see God is working. God works through his people, you and me. And in this story, he works through Ruth and Boaz. Boaz seems to be a bit of a big-time landowner. He seems wealthy, he has lots of people working for him, lots of fields, lots of grain. And Boaz notices Ruth. And he, from a distance, makes sure that she has food and drink and that she gets to gather the best grain. He protects her. He tells his servants to make sure that she's looked after and that no one bothers her. And he provides for her in a very practical way. God too watches us from afar, perhaps, but he provides for us in practical ways. And he works through us all. So as we face this new lockdown, and we feel maybe slightly in despair, we should take heart that God is watching over us and will provide for us. And I know how much you have all pulled together over the last few months in providing friendship, fellowship, support. And I do encourage you to carry on looking out for your neighbours and being that quiet presence for them. And hard as it is, God does have a plan. We may not think there's much of a plan in another lockdown, but God has a plan, and he'll take his own time to see it through. If we look at the story of Ruth and Boaz and think forward several centuries, and we see Jesus. Jesus, whose ancestors were Ruth and Boaz. and we see that God works in mysterious ways, but he always works for the good of his people. We can trust that God has a plan and will bring good out of all situations, especially the bad ones. So our current situation is definitely worse, and worse from when I wrote my sermon earlier in the week. At that point, we weren't facing another national lockdown, and our area seems to be relatively unscathed. And yet here we are on the cusp of being asked to be in solidarity with those in the north and the Midlands, and wherever else the coronavirus is on the move. And as Christians, we look out for our brothers and sisters, wherever they are, whether it's in Stapleford or in Newcastle. Some of us will find ourselves, like Ruth, in very dire circumstances, with a loss of a job, income, businesses. It's going to be very hard, very hard. A lot of us will feel lonely and isolated. Some of us will have very poor health, both physical and mental. There's a lot of fear and uncertainty and stress. But God speaks into the heart of despair. Like Ruth, we can look forwards and not back. Trust that God is with us, and that God sticks with us and watches over us. He provides, heals, and protects. Trust God brings good out of every situation. And some of us may be like Boaz, in a position to help others less fortunate than ourselves. Boaz was kind. Last week we were thankful. This week we're thinking of somebody who was kind, who showed real practical kindness. Maybe that's something we can do ourselves in our current situation. Being kind in a hostile and fractured world is hard, but it doesn't cost us anything to say a few kind words or to smile as we go about, even with the masks. I know it's difficult to smile behind masks, but we can do it. And by being kind, we can help others feel better. There's a collective feeling of distress, I think, in this country. And if we carry on treating each other well and being kind, that can help. But we could also offer practical help if we're able to. We can offer to do the shopping again, picking up prescriptions again. And we can also make donations to those charities that might really be struggling now to find funding. We have two wonderful charities we support here, the Children's Society and the Warden Scheme. So if you're able to, please do think about supporting them in that very practical way. And we must always hold on and cling on to the hope and trust that God is with us. He watches over us. He works through people and brings good out of every situation, even if we can't sense his presence, even if we feel he's absent. He's not. He is a quiet presence, watching, providing, and working to bring good to our lives. God encourages us to play our part in this. And we can do this by being kind and thankful. And like Ruth, acting and making sure that we look out for one another. And I think we can look forward in hope that all will be well, because God has got us and he's got this. So do keep hoping and trusting in him. And now let us join together to affirm our faith. Please do stand if you're able. And let us say together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived
by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Again, I'm using the hymn For All the Saints, so we're getting a good dose of it today. At the end of each verse, it says, Hallelujah, Hallelujah. Maybe you could say all the words, 197, or you can just join in with the Hallelujahs. So let us pray. For all the saints who from their labours rest, who thee by faith before the world confessed, thy name, O Jesus, be forever blessed. Hallelujah, Hallelujah. We can praise the Lord for who he is. He is strong and mighty. He's the great creator of all this beautiful world. He's the giver of all good gifts, who loves and cares for all that he's made. Jesus said, I will build my church. And we give thanks that all down the ages, he has built up that body through darkness and suffering to still rejoice and call him Lord. We thank you for the saints of old, great and small, who went on believing and trusting and living their lives for him. Thou wast their rock, their fortress and their might. Thou, Lord, their captain in the well-fought fight. Thou in the darkness drear, their one true light. Hallelujah, Hallelujah. What dark days we live in. All seems turmoil, fear, struggle. We pray for countries at war where peace seems impossible and for refugees fleeing those wars. We pray for those who suffer for their faith, Christians who knew they would suffer when they began to believe and who are imprisoned, tortured, disappeared. Churches are locked up or burned down or infiltrated, and it's a fearful thing to go to those churches. We do pray today for Nazanin Zaghari Ratcliffe, who is due to come to another trial tomorrow. Please, Lord, give her hope of release and home to her daughter Gabriella and her husband Richard. And COVID and yet another lockdown. You are the God of hope. May we, as your church, cry out to you, who still holds the whole world in his hands. Give wisdom to those who are seeking a vaccine, strength to doctors and nurses, hope to those who are sick and those who have lost or will lose loved ones. And beside that, there is the horror of economies being shattered, jobs lost, businesses closing. And there's the loneliness of lockdown. Please, Lord, save us. Oh, may thy soldiers, faithful, true and bold, fight as thy saints who nobly fought of old, and win with them the victor's crown of gold. Hallelujah, Hallelujah. We pray for your church, the body of Christ worldwide, to stand firm in faith, cast aside petty quarrels, hold high the word of truth, pray in the power of your Holy Spirit, show love and care for all you put in our paths, go on when it seems impossible, and for this church here, that our leaders may be blessed and strong in you, Simon, Claire, the church wardens, the PCC, the pastoral team, John and our choir, Zoe, Zach and all the Sunday school and youth work. The service outdoors even now, bless them, Lord. And we pray for Natching Wales and the Children's Society. May we be lights in Stapleford that go on burning and pass on light to others. And when the strife is fierce, the warfare long, steals on the ear the distant triumph song, and hearts are brave again, and arms are strong. Hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
We bring to you all who find this time frightening. We pray for doctors and nurses, health centres, our dear Adam Brooks, for the school, staff and children, and all who bring cheer. May we find inner resources to smile, to encourage, to brighten up the lives of others, even in these dark days. We pray for care homes. I pray for Betty. They're afraid that they won't be able to have visitors yet again. We remember those who are sick and those who grieve the loss of loved ones. And we pray for Kay Coe, Liz Hodgkins, Margaret Pollard, Mary Hunt. The golden evening brightens in the west. Soon, soon to faithful warriors cometh rest. Sweet is the calm of paradise the blessed. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
And finally, we pray for ourselves. Lord Jesus, you say you will never leave us nor forsake us. Help us to trust you, to believe you, even when we cannot see what is happening. For you know the end from the beginning. And one day, the clouds will break and we will see the sun again. May we be on our way, joining those faithful saints of old who blossomed where they were planted and kept the faith. But lo, there breaks a yet more glorious day. The saints triumphant rise in bright array. The King of glory passes on his way. Hallelujah,
hallelujah,
hallelujah. From earth's wide bounds, from ocean's farthest coast, through gates of pearls streams in the countless host, singing to Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Hallelujah,
hallelujah,
amen.
The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
To you we come, Father of lights, with angels and saints, where heaven and earth unite. May Jesus meet us in the breaking of the bread. We give you thanks because in him you have received us as your sons and daughters, joined us in one fellowship with the saints, and made us citizens in your kingdom. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing. Saying, take, eat, this is my body. which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself, made once for us all upon his cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom, and with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord. Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Accept through him, our great high priest, this sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat these and drink these holy gifts, in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in heaven and earth, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honour and glory and power be yours forever. And let us now join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share.
Thank you.
Eucharist, you have brought us near to an innumerable company of angels and to the spirit of the saints made perfect. As in this food of our earthly pilgrimage, we have shared their fellowship, so may we come to share their joy in heaven through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now let us join together in thanksgiving after our communion. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. And now, just before our final hymn, just a couple of notices. This evening we have a wonderful evening of music and prayer and quiet reflection as a commemoration of those dearly beloved departed. And that's here this evening at 6:30, where we'll be remembering those we love, who we have lost, and the choir will be singing some very beautiful pieces. There are spaces, so please do come along to that. It would be great to see you. And as I've already announced, we will not be having a remembrance service here next week. We're going to try and do something online, so please bear with us, and either Simon or myself will be in touch via email this week to fill you in a bit more what's going on within the next month. And now, John, would you like to lead the choir with a final hymn? We're doing the last few verses of All the Saints, which I think was, yes, 197. So if you'd like to follow along in your hymn books, please do. It's verses 5 to 7.
Four to eight.
There you go. So, thank you.
From All the Saints floating out to us saints outside, and have Mozart, clarinet, whatever it was, Sinatra floating out to It's very, very sad that we're being stopped from meeting again. We've done everything we possibly can to avoid being a source of infection, but there we are. We're part of our wider community and we will play our part. We really look forward to when we can meet again, when we saints of God can meet again. So hang on for that day and we shall be back. I hope it will be in early December. Not quite sure I'd be as confident as the government that 4 weeks will do it, but maybe they know best. So God bless you all and we'll see you when we see you in a few weeks' time.
I'd just like to echo, look forward to seeing you again, hopefully very soon. God bless you all. And now a blessing for us all. May the God who kindled the fire of his love in the hearts of the saints pour upon you the riches of his grace. May he give you joy in their fellowship and a share in their praises. May he strengthen you to follow them in holiness and to come to the full radiance of glory. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and those you love this day and always. Amen. Following God's saints in the ways of holiness and truth, go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.